everyone, we are getting ready to talk about bailment and pledge. Okay, this is a part of Indian Contract Act and it comes under special contracts. As we know, see, under special contracts, there are three sets of contracts which we are going to study. One is indemnity and guarantee, bailment and pledge, and agency. In this particular video, we will be talking about bailment and pledge. Okay, let's start our discussion with the bailment and then we will talk about pledge. Before we go into a detail about bailment's definition, which is given in Contract Act 1872, let us take an example. Mr. A and Mr. B. Mr. B is a tailor. Okay, so he purchases 2 meters of cloths and gives it to B, who is a tailor, 2 meters of cloth. And the purpose of giving this is to stitch a shirt. For that, A is going to give 500 rupees. And after that, once B stitches it, delivers it back to A. Final delivery. Final delivery of a shirt, right? So then he will give the final delivery of a shirt and receives 500 rupees, right? Here there is a transfer of goods from A to B first, right? He is transferring a shirt piece, cloth 2 meters to B for the purpose of stitching a shirt and with a remuneration of 500. Once the shirt is stitched, once the cloth is stitched into a shirt, and then the tailor is going to return it back to A. Okay. So, let us see the definition now. A bailment is the delivery of goods by one person to another for some purpose upon a contract that they shall, when the purpose is accomplished, be returned or otherwise disposed of according to the direction of the person delivering to them. Here, the first thing is A is transferred one person to another. There is a delivery of goods, which is cloth. And there is a purpose. The purpose is the tailor has to stitch the shirt. And then for that, B is going to get 500 as a remuneration. After the purpose is accomplished, the tailor, the receiver has to return the goods to the owner or according to the directions of the owner. Whoever, like owner says, instead of this shirt handing it over to me, you hand it over to my son, Mr. D. Okay, then tailor will hand it over to D. So this is a bailment, where there is a transfer of goods from one person to other, but not the ownership of the goods. There is just a transfer of the goods for some purpose. After the goods is accomplished, then the goods will come back to the owner or the directions of the owner. So this is called as a bailment. The person who is delivering the goods, first instance, right, he is called as a bailer. The person who is keeping the goods or who performs certain activities on the goods based on the contract is called as bailee. Okay, who is bailer? The bailer is a person delivering the goods. Who is bailee? The person to whom the goods were delivered is called as bailee. So let us see few examples. We discussed already about tailor. So we have already discussed tailor here. And now let us see lending books on returnable basis. A is here and B is here. A runs a library. Okay. So he gives book to B and B reads the book and then returns it back to library. So this is a bailment. Special bailments here, what one is a seizure of goods by a customs. Okay, what is custom? It is a gateway for goods to enter from a foreign country. Any foreign country goods, when it comes to India by way of ship or road transport or air transport, it goes through a custom check, and Once it is cleared, then it will be brought into India for a sale or anything, right? Any goods which comes here. Okay, here is a case when one person brings the goods from a foreign country. Custom finds that there is some issue in the documentation. They say that leave the goods here. So they seize the goods. Seize the goods. So now a person who has come from a foreign country, Mr. A, left the goods with the custom. He goes out and get the documentation ready, comes back to custom, show the documentation and take the goods out of it. In this case, a custom officer who collects the goods, who sees the goods, is called as a bailee. Okay, so this was held in the case of State of Gujarat versus M.M. Haji Hassan. Any seizure of a goods by a custom officer, in that case, the custom officers will be treated as a bailee. So they have to return back the goods to the owner when owner submits all the relevant documents. Clear? And the next example is on a post office. A goes to a post office and gives some parcel which was to be sent it to Mr. Q, who is in Mumbai. Assume A is in Bangalore, he goes to a Bangalore post office and asks them to send the goods to Q, who is in Mumbai. Correct? So in this case, a post officer will be treated as a bailee because there is a purpose for which that goods is transferred. A is treated as a bailer and goods will be delivered to person who is in Mumbai, Mr. Q. It is as per the direction of a A. So the definition says, right? Okay. So the post office will be acting as a bailee here. This was held in the case of Income Tax Commissioner versus R.M. Rathod. Acceptance of article by post office for VPP parcel. So it will be treated as bailment. Hope guys you are clear. There is a transfer of goods. There should be some purpose. But at the same time, the goods should be returned back to the bailer or bailer's direction. Okay, this is all about bailment. So first condition is somebody has to transfer the goods. But here is a some case where there is a bailment without any contract. For example, it is a finder of goods. You might have heard about quasi contract, right? Quasi contracts are not a contract by a proper legal way, but this will be called as a contract, right? There will not be any agreement, there will not be any offer, acceptance, but still this will have characteristics of a contract. Out of that, the one is a finder of goods. Okay, so the one important part is finder of goods. Who is finder of goods? Finder of goods is someone, if A lost his 50 grams of gold chain, B finds it. So in this case, B is a finder of the goods. So what is his position? He has to find the owner and return it back. So till that time, his position will be similar to a bailee. Okay. So there is no two parties involved. There is no contract or anything. But still, from the contract perspective, the finder of goods position is a bailee. And there's the relationship between the owner and the finder of goods is like a bailment. Okay, this is a quasi contract. We will discuss about the rights and duties of a finder of goods in a later stage. Okay, now most important thing. You know the locker facility functionalities in a bank. Okay, you know the locker facilities in the bank. So Mr. A goes to State Bank of India and opens a locker. Hires a locker, I can say it is a hires a locker, and then SBI provides him a locker space, right? Every day or a weekly once he goes there and keeps his gold chain, silver bars, or some cash. Well, yet and a property document, like all these things he keeps here, and then one day again he will takes out whatever. So he will be doing a regular transactions here. Does this amount to a bailment? Is it a bailment? Is this a bailment? Answer is no. This was held in the case of Atul Mehra versus Bank of Maharashtra. What is the basic feature of a bailment? One person transfers the goods to B for some purpose, and then after that B returns to it, right? But in this case, in case of a bank, State Bank of India case, banker is giving a place on hire. And what A does here, whether he keeps a gold, silver or cash or property documents, that information banker will not be having, right? Here in the case of a bailment, the B will be knowing why he is receiving the goods and what action he has to perform and then when he has to return it. But in the case of a locker, the situation is not like that. A keeps here and then A takes it back. Bank will not be knowing what are the items are in the locker, what items A is taking every time. So in this case, this is not called as a bailment. This was held again in the case of Atul Mehra versus Bank of Maharashtra. Guys, we discussed in detail about bailment's definition. I hope you guys are clarified with the questions on clarified with the concept of bailment, all the doubts, whatever you had. See, the bailment is a contract where one person delivers the goods to other person for some specific purpose, and once the purpose is accomplished, the other party will return goods to the owner or according to his direction. The person who delivers the goods initially is called as a bailer. The person who receives it is called as bailee. Okay, we discussed the example of a tailor lending books, or then we discussed about seizure of a goods by customs office, and then acceptance of articles by a post office. All these are the examples of a bailment, and finder of goods, quasi contract case, also will be considered as a bailment, and the finder of goods has to return, make a reasonable effort to return the goods to a owner. And but hiring a locker itself doesn't amount to a bailment. Okay, this is all about the bailment, and next we will discuss what are the essentials of the bailment, and then what are the kinds of the bailment. Okay, I take a pause just to recap whatever we discussed, and after 30 seconds we will talk about what are the kinds of bailment and what are the essentials of bailment. So I'm taking a pause here. I hope you guys are noting these points. Okay, coming to new point of discussion, essentials of bailment. What are the essentials of a bailment? We clearly discussed, right, while discussing definition, one person has to transfer the goods and other person receives it and keeps it, and then there will be some purpose why the goods are transferred, and then it will be returned back. So there should be a delivery of a movable goods from one person to another. Important point, right? But it is not being his servant. So very, very simple, right? If A asks his servant to take the goods from house and keep it in a storeroom, is this a bailment? No. If there is a master-servant relation, then it is not a bailment. There should be a transfer of movable property one person to another where there is no master and servant agreement. Okay. This delivery of goods, like A to B, tailor, we are transferring cloth. This kind of movement will be essential. Okay. There should be a transfer or a delivery of a goods or any movable goods. Okay. The important point to remember here is the goods transferred may be a actual or constructive. What is actual delivery of goods? where specific goods will be transferred from one person to other, A to B. Cloth, the tailor will be transferring it, or book will be transferred. The goods will be transferred from one person to other. That is called as a actual delivery. Then what is constructive delivery? What is constructive delivery? Constructive delivery is something, if A owns a godown, okay, A is having a godown where he has timber or a wood, right? Then B, who is a carpenter, A says to B, boss, you come to my godown and make some furnitures out of the wood. For that, A hands over key of a godown to B. Is he actually, product is moving from here to here? No. Product will remain at the same place, but in case of a constructive thing, he will give symbolically the key of a godown to a B. And then B comes here and then works on it. So the goods will remain at the same place, but the delivery happens constructive way, which is like a transfer of a key, handing over of a key. Clear, guys? The actual physical movement of a goods here, but in case of a constructive, the goods remain at the same place, but there will be an alternate way of delivering to it. The one way is giving a key to a key of a godown to a carpenter. Hope you guys are clear. The important essential element is there should be a delivery of goods. The delivery of goods may be actual or constructive. Okay, moving to a second point, there should be a delivery for some purpose. Multiple times we discussed, there should be some purpose why I am delivering goods to a other party. I am delivering it to a tailor for stitching a cloth. I am delivering book because on a rental basis and he will read it, right? The person is handing over a car for a trip or for a security purpose, he is storing there, right? There should be some purpose. If any delivery without any purpose, if there is a delivery and that delivery is without purpose, then it is no bailment situation. This was held in the this was described in section 148 of the Act. Remember, guys, if there is no purpose, then this is not a bailment. So there should be a purpose. Okay, there should be a delivery of goods, there should be a purpose. No purpose, no bailment. If there is no purpose, then there is no bailment. Okay, what is the third condition? Whenever goods are finished, like the purpose is accomplished, then the goods should be returned back to the owner or as per the direction of the owner, right? It should be returned back to the owner or as per the direction of the bailer. So this is another essential. Okay, the basic of all other things of the bailment is an agreement. There should be some agreement, right? Otherwise, why the person leaves the goods in somebody's place? There should be some agreement. Even in case, we already discussed, like if there is no agreement also, in certain cases, if there is no agreement, even then also it will be considered as bailment. What is that case? That case is finder of goods. Except that in most of the cases, there should be an agreement. So the four essentials are: there should be agreement, there should be a delivery of goods, there should be some purpose. At the end of the purpose, after the accomplishment of the purpose, the goods should be returned back to the owner or bailer or as per the direction of the bailer. These are the four essential elements of a bailment. With this, I take a pause and you make a note of this, and then we will move to a next topic, kinds of a bailment. Okay, guys, we have been discussing concept of bailment and then essentials of bailment, the topics related to bailment. And now we will touch upon kinds of bailment. Okay, what are the different kinds of bailment? At a high level, this classification on the bailment side can be done from a two viewpoints. First one is benefit point of view, and the second one is reward point of view. We will see first the benefit point of view. It is a bailment for the exclusive benefit of the bailer. The bailer who is the one who delivers the goods, right? Exclusive benefit of the bailer. The bailee will not be having any benefit here. The example of this is leaving goods in safe custody without paying. A, who is going for a picnic, he goes to B's place and says that he will leave his car in garage for 7 days. Okay, being a friend, right? So he accepts it. In this case, there is no payment from A to B, but A is keeping this car. Clear, guys? So it is exclusive benefit of only a bailer. Bailee is not benefited anything here. This is called as bailment for the exclusive benefit of bailer. Second case, bailment for the exclusive benefit of the bailee. This is a case where we loan something, the bailee loans something without paying any charges. For example, A and B here, B borrows a book from A and he doesn't pay any rent for it. And then afterwards he returns it. There is no rent, but he borrows a book, he reads it and then returns it back. So here the benefit is only for bailee. Bailer doesn't have any benefit here. Correct? There is no benefit to a bailer. These kinds of contract are called as bailment for the exclusive benefit of bailee. So we discussed this, bailer, and we discussed benefit, exclusive benefit of bailee. Bailment for exclusive benefit of bailee. Fine. And the third one is mutual benefit. This is a most important part of, like, kinds of a, one of the important kind of a bailment, where both the parties will get some benefit. Take an example of a tailor. A and B, he gives a cloth here. Then A gets back stitched shirt and B gets 500 rupees. So both the parties will get some benefit. These are called as mutual benefit kind of a bailment. From a reward perspective, there are two classification, gratuitous bailment and then non-gratuitous bailment. What is gratuitous? We do something on a kindness or from a societal well-being as a help. So in those cases, no party will be entitled for a remuneration. The same example, right? A keeps his car in B's house. So B is not getting any remuneration. Others, right? A lends book to B. B can read it, but A will not get any remuneration. So both the parties will get remuneration. But in case of non-gratuitous bailment, both the parties will get some benefits or some remuneration. There will be a reward. There will be, like, as we said, it is a mutual benefit contract. Okay, non-gratuitous are a mutual benefit. So there will be an agreement and they perform the duties as per that, and both the parties will get benefit in non-gratuitous contract bailments. Hope you guys are clear. We will be keep using the word gratuitous where there is no remuneration and non-gratuitous where there is a remuneration. We will be using these classification rather than the three what we discussed here. Okay, so I take a pause. You guys make a note of it. Okay, most important now, duties of the bailer. Just to recap, who is a bailer and a bailee, I am taking the example A and B. A transfers some goods to here and after the purpose is achieved, B returns it back. It is a delivery and then here is a return. So in this case, A is a bailer, the person who transfer or who delivers the goods, and B is a bailee, the person who receives the goods or the person to whom goods are delivered. Clear? Okay, we discussed in this detail from the beginning, right? So now at brief, bailer and bailee is here. Then what is the duties? What are the duties of a bailer? As a bailer, what are the duties he has to perform? The first one, he has to disclose faults in the goods he has bailed. Okay, he, as we discussed, he is transferring clothes. So he should disclose or tell to B that, okay, if there is a hole in a cloth, or instead of 2 meters of cloth, if it is 1.9 meter, he should disclose that. Whatever the fault is there in that particular goods, that should be disclosed by the bailer to the bailee. So here is an interesting case on this. It is a Reed versus Dean, one of the important case in the with respect to a bailer's duty, where he has to disclose fault in the goods bailed. In this case, a person A and B assume, okay, A takes a motor launch from B, okay, and then there was some technical problem with the motor launch, which B will not disclose to A. They will not disclose the technical problem associated with the motor launch. When A started using it, the motor launch attracts fire and destroys, and A get injured in this cycle. Okay, there was a technical challenge, B didn't disclose that. When A uses that, A suffers some problem. So B is a giver here, who is a bailer, and A is a bailee because he has taken a goods, correct? So it is a duty of the bailer to inform the bailee that there is some problem with the machine, but B has not informed it. So B is responsible for this. This was held in the case of Reed and Dean. If a bailer failed to explain the defaults in the goods, whatever bailed, then bailer is responsible for all the consequences. Clear, guys? So it is a responsibility of the bailer to disclose all the faults. Next, it is a duty of the bailer to repay the necessary expenses in case of gratuitous bailment. Okay, what is gratuitous bailment? In case of gratuitous bailment, both the parties will not get a benefit. Okay, for example, A leaves his pet in a B's house. A is going out on vacation, so he kept his dog in B's house. So B spent some amount on his food. So it is a gratuitous because there is no remuneration received by B for this act. So he spent on a food or some medical expenses, as a thing. So when A comes back, in this particular case of the relationship, B can claim the expenses incurred on a food and medicines from A. So it is a duty of the bailer, who A is a bailer here, right? Who is transferring the property to B here, transferring the goods to B. In this case, A has to refund all these expenses, necessary expenses. It is a duty of a bailer. Same way, in case of non-gratuitous bailment, what is non-gratuitous bailment? In the non-gratuitous bailment, both the parties will enjoy certain remuneration. When A leaves a dog at a B's place, B will get rupees 1000 as per agreement towards a food. So that is the necessary expenses. Okay, he is getting 1000 rupees as a return. So B has to take care of the food. So B will not get additional money for a food. But if there is some extraordinary expenses, the dog fell ill and then B took that dog to a doctor's pet clinic, and where he spends 10,000 rupees. Then it is a duty of a bailer to return this extraordinary expenses only, but not for a food, because food is expenses which is already been covered with the 1,000 rupees service charge. It is a non gratuitous. So then in this particular case, A has to pay rupees 10,000 to B, because B incurred this is the extraordinary expenses, right? Any extraordinary expenses incurred should be returned. Hope you guys are clear, both in case of gratuitous and non-gratuitous. In case of gratuitous, all necessary expenses will be reimbursed, whether it is for necessary or extraordinary, all those things will be reimbursed. But in case of non-gratuitous, only extraordinary expenses will be reimbursed. And duty to indemnify bailee. Indemnify means cover the losses of a bailee. If bailee incurs any loss because of the product whatever bailer has given, and then bailer has to indemnify bailee for the loss suffered by bailee. So here a motor example we discussed, right? The loss was suffered, the injury occurred to Mr. A, who is a bailee. So whatever the loss he has suffered, that bailee has to indemnify that. So indemnify the losses suffered by bailee. So this is given in section 164. These are the duties of the bailer: disclose the fault, otherwise bailer will be held responsible, and then repay all the expenses or extraordinary expenses, and then indemnify the bailee in case of any loss suffered. Clear guys, these are the duties of the bailer. I take a pause here and then we will move to duties of a bailee. Okay, duties of the bailee. We are discussing now duties of the bailee. What are the duties of a bailee? Okay, we know A is sending some goods to B for some purpose. After that, B returns it. It is delivery here and then again it is a return here. A is a bailer and B is a bailee. Okay. So we discussed what are his duties. Then what are his duties? He also do certain activities, right? The first duty of a bailee is he should take a reasonable care of the goods. Whatever goods he has received, he should take a reasonable care. What does it mean? Reasonable care means if it is his own property, how he is to act. The same way bailee here also he has to act. Whether it is a bailment goods or his own goods, he should take a reasonable care of the goods. And then, bailee should not make an unauthorized use of a goods. Unauthorized use of the goods is not permitted. Take an example, A is here and B. So, this example only. A gives a car to B for a rent. After that, B should use it for his personal use and return it back after 1 week, right? Based on the agreement. If instead of that, if B rented to a C and B rented this to a D for 3 days and 4 days here, then it is an unauthorized use, right? As per the contract, he has to use for his purpose and then return it back. So he should not do a subletting. So this kind of unauthorized use of the goods should not be done. If this kind of unauthorized use is done, then A can cancel the contract and take back the goods immediately. Duty to not to mix the bailed goods with his own goods. Okay, so bailee should take a reasonable care and he should not mix the goods, bailed goods with his, mix the goods with personal goods. He should keep it separately and he should manage it properly. He should not mix the goods with his personal goods. And it is a duty of the bailer to return the goods. Once the purpose is over, once the purpose is accomplished, the important essential of a bailment is bailee has to return the goods back to the bailer. Correct? So they have to return back the goods. once tailor stitches the cloth and the shirt is ready, so Bailey tailor has to return it back to A. He cannot deny that. Okay, the other important is the any accretion to the goods. Any profit arises of that goods also should be returned back to the bailer. Take a example, A leaves his dog with B for 2 months. Okay, when A comes back from his long vacation of 2 months, there will be 2-3 puppies. Okay, from the dog. So then it is a duty of B to return the dog along with 2 puppies to Mr. E. Any profit arises on that bailed goods, the bailee has to return it back. Say the same example, A gives B a cow and then cow lays a calf. So he has to return cow along with calf. Both the things should be returned back. So any profit arises of the goods which are bailed, that should be returned back to bailer. Okay guys, these are the duties of the bailee. So reasonable care of the goods. Okay, reasonable care of the goods, no unauthorized use of the goods. You should not mix the goods with the personal goods, and you should return the goods. It is a duty to return all the profits associated with that goods. Clear? I take a pause here. Okay, so let us discuss rights of the bailee and the rights of the bailer. So first we will start our discussion with the rights of the bailer, and then we can talk about right of the bailee. What are the rights of the bailer? Bailer has a right to terminate the contract, terminate the bailment if goods are wrongfully used. Section 153 empowers bailer to end the contract or terminate the bailment if the bailee uses the goods wrongfully, unauthorized use. Right? It is a duty of the bailee not to make unauthorized use of a product. If bailee does unauthorized use of the product, then bailer can terminate the contract straight away. So the example we discuss, A gives a car to B for rent, but and then B has to return it back after the trip, but B lends it to C and D. So in this case, A can take back, terminate the bailment and take back the goods. And under section 159, bailment says, okay, the contract act says, right to demand return of the goods at any time in case of a gratuitous bailment. We know gratuitous bailment where there is no benefit for both the parties. A lends book to B on a personal relation, okay, for 7 days. They agreed that it is for 7 days. It is a gratuitous payment, bailment where B is not paying any cash or any rent for the book. In this case, after 3 days, if A wants that book back, so he can call B and ask for book, return of a book. Okay. So any time in case of a gratuitous bailment, the bailer can ask for a return of the goods any time. Clear? These are the rights of the bailer. What are the rights of the bailee? One is right to get compensation. Whatever is agreed for stitching a shirt, 500 rupees, that compensation should be given back, given to bailee. So bailee can claim that compensation any time, right? Once he delivers the goods, so he can claim that the amount should be coming from the bailer to him. So there is no question on that. So he is having right to claim his compensation. Right to necessary expenses or remuneration. As we discussed, right, in case of a gratuitous bailment, if there is some expenses, necessities, or in case of non-gratuitous bailment, special extraordinary expenses. In those cases, all these extraordinary expenses or a special necessary expenses can be claimed by bailee. It is a right of the bailee. whatever were the duties of the bailer is becomes a right of the bailee. Simple. Okay, right to sue. If bailer refuses to give a compensation or returning of this necessary expenses, then bailee can sue this bailer. No doubt in that. The important aspect of a rights of bailee is a right of lien. Important aspect of a right of a bailee is the right of lien. What does it mean? Right of lien means if the bailee's lawful charges are not paid, he may retain the goods. So bailee should get compensation, and what all the bailee should get? He should get compensation, and then he should get necessary expenses. If he is not getting this, he can retain the goods. This is called as right of lien. If the bailee is not getting his benefits, his expenses, his compensation, then he can retain the goods. That particular retaining of the goods is called as right of lien of a bailee. Okay, so the right of lien can be of two forms. One is a particular lien and another one is a general lien. What is particular lien? In case of a particular lien, he can retain the goods for which he has given some service, right? Or he has done some work. For example, tailor, right? Tailor. So A and B, who is a tailor? B is a tailor here. So goods is cloth is given and he stitched it. So he has given this service here. So if bailer is not paying the money for that, then he can retain this shirt. He can retain this shirt until bailer pays the cash to him. Clear? So this is a particular lien. For whatever services he has given, that item he can retain it. That is called as right of lien. That is called as particular right of lien. In case of general lien, little complex here. Okay, in case of general lien, let us take an example. The same example of a tailor. A and B. A has given cloth for shirting to B, and then also for pant, for also suit. So three pairs of cloths he has given. One is for shirt, one is for pant, another one is for suit. If he fails to pay the amount for a pant, in a particular lien situation, he can retain only a pant. But in case of a general lien situation, he can retain all the cloths. Even if he fails only for a pant also, but in this case, he can retain all the three cloths, whatever he is having it. So in case of particular lien, he holds specific particular product. That is a right. In case of a general lien, he can hold all the goods which he has received for a bailment. Okay. One particular item, one to one, then it is a particular lien. All goods of the bailment, then it is a general lien. This was held in the case, general lien right was held in the case of Jovit and Sons versus Union Cold Storage Company. In this, it is a storage, cold storage area where company keeps the meats. So infrequently, right? Every time the lot comes here, first lot here, second lot here, third lot here. And if they fail to pay the rent, then bailee can retain all the goods, irrespective of, like, he has paid rent for this, he has paid for this, but he has not paid for this. But irrespective of that, he can retain the entire goods. So that is called as general lien. Hope you guys are clear. Right of particular lien is for a same item for which he has given service. In case of general lien, he can exercise the right of lien for all the products which are bailed to him. Before we conclude the topic of bailment, let us discuss rights of a finder of goods. Finder of goods is a quasi contract What is quasi contract? This is a contract where there is no formal agreement. Based on the situation, this will be termed as a contract. One of the cases is finder of the goods. No one should get benefited from the loss of others. So owner who is losing the goods and someone who finds the goods, it is a duty of that finder of goods to return back, make all reasonable effort to return it back to the owner. Okay, in this case, so finder of goods will be called as bailee. The finder of goods is called as bailee. So his duties and rights are similar to a bailee only. So what are the duties of a bailee? So he has to return it back. This is important duty, right? Return it back to owner. So he has to return it back. What are the rights of the bailee? He can claim expenses, necessary expenses, whatever expenses he has incurred. Or he can also claim compensation. If he is not getting the compensation, then he can exercise right of lien, right? So what are the rights of the bailee here? What are the rights of the finder of goods here? He can claim for all the expenses, necessary expenses or a compensation. And then if he is not able to receive the compensation, he can exercise a right of lien. Okay, for example, a finder of a dog, he fed the dog for 20 days for 200 rupees. And then he has to get 200 rupees from the owner. Otherwise, he can keep the dog until he gets that money. This was held in the court case, right? Clear? So the finder of goods will be considered as bailee, and his rights are, two important rights are to claim reclaim the expenses incurred on that goods, and also if the amount, he is not getting the amount, then he can exercise a right of lien. Okay guys, that's it from the bailment side, and we will discuss bailment, the pledge in the next video. Thank you so much for listening us, listening me on the bailment. I request you to please subscribe my channel, and I'll be uploading a pledge related video in couple of days. Thank you very much.